Good morning, students. Today we'll start with where we left in the last lecture. We were talking about the plant, how we can make the transgenic plant for the different purposes. So what I told you in the last lecture was plant can be utilized both qualitatively as well as the quantitatively. Plant can be used for the different purposes. For example, like, you know, we can use the plant for the production of certain secondary metabolites. Plants can be used for the enhanced protein. Plant can be used for the enhanced carbohydrate, enhanced lipid, or certain vitamins. I told you about the golden rice, which can be used, you know, with the higher vitamin D level. I told you the canola, we can use the, you know, vitamin E. Iron content can be increased in the plant as well by using the this technique. Or plants can be used as a source of the molecular farming, where we can produce the various nutraceuticals, which are, you know, the herbal products, many secondary metabolites that you've been told in the biomolecules, like alkaloids, saponins. We can use, you know, the many of the glycosides, cardiac glycosides. So many of the those herbal products can be used in the plant. Again, the plant, like, you know, the many plants can be used. For example, one plant is the tomato. We know the tomato, it gets deteriorate, you know, very soon. So one variety of the tomato, that's called a flavor saver. It is a tomato. So we can put a gene by using that, you know, the plant, and, you know, especially the tomato, the shelf life of the tomato can be increased. How do we know? In the tomato, like, you know, the flavor saver, it looks, you know, good and having more shelf life. It can be used for many days. Normally, if the tomato is not used for that purpose, so tomato gets, you know, the spoiled very soon. So can we introduce certain genes to keep the, you know, tomato viable for a long time? That will, you know, incur a lot of losses for the farmers. So flavor saver was one of the variety where the over ripening or the ripening process has been delayed. So this tomato can be used for the many days. Okay. Similarly, many, you know, the plant can be, you know, made, you know, the transgenic. So transgenic, many, you know, the transgenic can be used. Especially in the crop sciences, we can use against the bacterial infection, or we can make, you know, the bacterial resistant plant, fungal resistant. We can make, you know, the viral resistant. Insect resistant. On the other hand, we can make the plant against the herbicide resistant. So these are the few ways we can create the plant. Especially those crops, they have huge losses because of, you know, the infection with the different, especially the plant, they have, you know, the three kind of infections: the bacterial, fungal, and, you know, the viral. In some cases it could be the nematode that can also infect the plant. But the one which is, you know, the incurring a lot of losses is the insect. So those insects, they feed upon the plants, and, you know, the those plants, you know, is going to be lost. Because if you look at the plant, you know, yield, that has been reduced quite a lot by those insects. Keeping that in the mind, there was one gene which has been introduced. That gene we called as a BT gene. BT gene is against the insect. This is, you know, the insecticidal gene. Actually, it is coding for a protein. We call it a pistil protein. And this pistil protein is insecticide, especially the bollworms, lepido, you know, the terans, you know, dipterans. These are the few insects older which are, you know, the can be killed. So first plant that is met, you know, out of it was the Bt cotton. Bt cotton was like, you know, the one, even this is the only plant which is being used in India, you know, as a transgenic one. Okay, so Bt cotton can be used for the purpose. It cannot infect a cotton plant, and the cotton plant is resistant against the, you know, insects. Okay, exactly what is the Bt cotton mean? Bt means that, you know, we got it from a bacteria, that is a Bacillus thuringiensis. Okay, so this is a bacteria. From where we got a protein, it's called cryo-1. See this, you know, the many protein, actually this is a crystal protein. Name of the protein is crystal and name of the gene is cryo-1ac. It has been seen the spores of this bacteria has an insecticidal property. So they kill the insects, especially the, as you told, the Leptoderma, dipterans and bollworms. These were the three different category of the insects. You know, they can be killed by the, you know, Bt gene or Bacillus thuringiensis gene. Actually the name of the gene was cryo-1ac. It's a huge variety of, you know, the cry proteins present in the Bacillus thuringiensis depending upon the strain of the bacteria. So it has been seen like, you know, the spore making bacteria, and those spores are able to kill the insects, and that property has been utilized, you know, at large by, you know, for the killing of those insects. And this team has been introduced into the in the cotton plant. Later on, you know, the Bt brinjal, then, you know, the many other Bt cannabis, then the many other plant which get infected easily or which get, you know, infested by the insects. So those genes, like, you know, they are going to, you know, basically kill the insects. How they actually kill is that, you know, in the gut where the high pH is there. So these proteins get activated at the high pH, especially at the epithelial cell, that is called the plus border cells, you know, in the gut of the insects. They get activated and, like, you know, they kill those cells, and as a result, insect is going to be killed. So we get a gene that is called the Bt gene. Bt stands for Bacillus thuringiensis, and this encodes for a protein called a crystal protein. And to be specific, this was the cryo-1ac gene which has been introduced in the Bt cotton, and that was the first plant in India which has been introduced, you know, at the field level. Other, you know, the you know, plants or the transgenic plants, they are, you know, not at the field level because they require approval from a committee, that is called GEAC, Genetic Engineering Approval Committee. So GEAC is, you know, this is, you know, the genetic engineering. Approval committee. Again, in India, this, you know, the committee gives, you know, the base for any plant that has been, you know, the converted with a transgenic, first require the clearance from the GEAC committee, and once it gets clearance, then only the field trial, and it can be introduced into the, you know, therapy form. Okay, so let's talk about some other, you know, the transgenic plant which is against the disease resistance. And there's a many other way it has been, you know, the use, like, you know, the insect is a huge you know, enemy of the crop, and entire world has a problem with the insects. So a lot of research has been put in, and there are many ways, not only the BT cotton, there will be many ways, like, you know, the trypsin inhibitor, amylase inhibitors, and then the many other ways insect can be, you know, killed or not be allowed to, you know, eat the crops. Usually insect infest only those plants which are rich in the protein or they are rich in the carbohydrate. So they have, you know, these proteins. Similarly, the viral infection, especially the whenever we make the transgenic plant, so there's a lot of, you know, the strategy made. So one which is, you know, the most prevalent, if you put the code protein gene into the plants, so plant prepared itself for, you know, removing the, you know, the viruses, you know, once it gets infected. Similarly, we use it for the bacteria and the fungal resistance as well. Then the last thing I would like to talk about is, like, you know, the herbicide resistance. These herbicides are one which is being used to, you know, remove the weeds, you know, which is grown with the crop. See, what happens is that, you know, when a crop is grown, so we have many grasses, many weeds, which are, you know, the just wild, they're not of any use. So they grow because we provide them with the fertilizer and other thing. So that prosper the growth of, you know, those weeds as well. But those weeds put a lot of, you know, the competition to the growing crop, and as a result, crop growth is inhibited or crop is not going to grow at its fullest potential. In that case, what is going to happen is that the stunted growth or the productivity of the crop is going to be reduced. So how to, you know, the work on that? So we create a herbicide resistant plant, because herbicides are not, you know, that specific. It doesn't know whether it has to kill a plant of one way or the other. So for them, the plant is plant. So we create herbicide resistant, you know, plant. So even we are giving the herbicide, those crops especially will not be killed, and the other weeds or herbs will be killed. So the weedicide or the herbicide resistant plant can be created, especially one which is being used is that, you know, there is one of the, you know, the herbs called Roundup. So Roundup, you know, resistant plants are, you know, grown. So these plants can be grown and it will not have any effect of the herbicide. So crop is going to be safer, and as a result, the weeds or the herbs in the surrounding areas will be kept. So that is the, you know, one of the advantages of the herbicide resistance in the transgenic plant. Okay. Again, like, you know, this field has a, you know, enormous potential. For example, I just give you the one example. Like, you know, the as a human being, we love, you know, the different color of the flower, right? We want, like, some exotic color of the flower, and many flower we just think over, use it to know, you know, PC, and you try to see the different color of the flower. Some of them are possible and some of them they are not. So that kind of flower can also be generated by making the transgenic plant. Basically, I told you in the biomolecule lecture, color of any flower is because of the flavonoid or the anthocyanin that it contains. So once you, you know, the change the substitution of the different groups on the flavonol ring, you are going to change the color of the flower. That is another big market for it. Similarly, the different color, you know, the fruits, vegetables, that can also be introduced in the market by making the transgenic. So the transgenic plant, they have the huge, you know, market, and the biotechnology is helping it out. Again, like, if I tell you in the detail, what you'll find is that, you know, as the our population is growing, so we cannot increase the land. So only thing that we can do is that, you know, we can increase the productivity, both quality wise and the quantity wise. At the same time, the different color, like, you know, the rich in the flavor. I told you the quality means, like, you know, you're going to introduce a lot of, you know, the protein, of the certain amino acids, or the flavonoids, or carotenoids, or the specific starch, or the specific lipid, or specific vitamins, those can be used. So this crop biotechnology or the agri biotechnology, the plant biotechnology, they have the huge advantages over the normal plant. Normally, I told you in the beginning itself that the breeding, earlier we used to produce those crop by using the crop breeding methods or the plant breeding methods, which is a lengthy process, may take a lot of time, may not yield the desirable result even in the end. So to get the desirable result and the fast way, so this is the field we call it as a plant or agriculture biotechnology. This is all about the plant. We discuss about the animal, we discuss about the plant. Similarly, I told you about the bacteria, they can be engineered to produce the many human proteins. I told you about the transgenic animals and their usage as well. I told you the dolly experiment on the last lecture, where I told you that how the dolly was actually used. Okay, and that was first kind of its experiment. Okay, so that is how the biotechnology field is growing like anything. Fine, it has the uses everywhere. Not only the producing the certain important product, but at the same time it could be used in cleaning the environment as well. We produce as human being, we produce different variety of the chemicals or the product which is the not biodegradable. So to convert them, to degrade them, we require the specific bacteria or the other microorganism that can be designed by using the biotechnology technique. Okay, so I hope this biotechnology part has helped you. Last part of the biotechnology is the human genome project. We call it as HGP. This human genome project is also called as HGP. It was like in the mind of a lot of scientists, because what we are all depends kind of protein that we produce, how we look, what disease we are going to get in the future, what is going to be stature, all it is decided by the kind of genes that we have. Okay, so one thing that attracted most to the scientists is the disease part. So how do we know prior to the disease happen? Because once the disease happen, the treatment is going to be the only thing that you can do. But can we predict those disease? Can we predict the ways a disease can be treated? Can we know what sort of population at the global level can be infected, can be having the disease? For example, India is called as world hub or the world capital of diabetes. So what happens in our genome? Why we Indians are the more prone to get the diabetes? So there are the many questions that is to be asked and to be answered. Okay, so we cannot know those without knowing the kind of genes, number of genes that we have in our body, what is going to be their sequence. Already been told in the molecular biology lectures that the human genome is the one that has a lot of information. So how to decipher those information, that was the way to go ahead. Okay, so that came for the first time in the mind of a scientist. His name was the Robert Sensimer was one. He conceived the concept of the human genome project in around 84-85. For the first time, it came in the mind of Robert, the Sensimer, along with many colleagues, and his collaborators across the globe, to go for sequencing the entire gene of the human, and we know the sequence. Because if you know the sequence, you can easily make out what is the protein it is going to make. So for keeping those mind, this was the conceit in the mind of the told you Robert Sensima, and he was the one to develop it. But this was just, you know, the kind of concept only, and the ground reality was very, very, you know, different. How to make the huge genome, okay, and how to make it. Look at, like, if we just go into the detail, I don't know how complex it can be. For example, like, you know, we have the 46 chromosome, right? You know, the 22 plus X, you know, Y or XX. So we have, you know, that, you know, the genome, and we know that the human genome contain around, you know, the 3 billion nucleotides. So we have, our genome has the 3 × 10⁻⁹ base pair in the human genome. When we talk about the genome, we always talk about in the haploid set. This much, you know, the base pair, we have the haploid set of chromosome. Okay? That means, if you see the diploid set, it is going to be 6 × 10⁻⁹ base pair. 6 billion base pair. But 3 billion if we know, so same copy is going to be in the next 3 billion. So whenever we discuss, we always talk about the this part. Now if you look at, if you calculate the size, so the size is going to be huge. We know one base pair is having a length of 3 to 4 nanometer. So if you multiply 3.4 nanometer with the 3 × 10⁻⁹, it will come, you know, and this is in the nanometer. So if you multiply this with the 10 power minus, this much is going to be in meter. So, you know, approximately it will come into the 1 meter. And if you see the diploid condition, so it's going to be 2 meters. Okay? Or 6 fet. And this is present in every cell. And we have, you know, the over billions of the cell. So just imagine, like, you know, how difficult it could be. Reading that many, you know, the bases could be very, very difficult. Okay? And every cell, again, just look at, like, you know, the 6 feet of the DNA is present in every single cell. And that is packaged with the help of the stone that I told in the previous lectures into a small place of few micrometer of diameter into the nucleus. So you have to take out those, you know, the DNA from the nucleus without, you know, the breaking it, intact DNA, and open up the DNA and read it. Just imagine how difficult this process is going to be. But it was thought in the beginning. So the work has been started on the Human Genome Project in the year 1990. There are two departments of the US which is involved. One was the DOE, Department of Energy, and National Institute of Health. Basically, the funding is given by these two departments. Department of DOE stands for the Department of Energy, and NIH is another organization that is called as National Institute of Health. It was a $3 billion, you know, dollar, you know, project. Huge amount is, you know, required to run this project. Huge. $3 billion is not a, you know, just a little money. It is huge amount. Okay? So these two organizations played a very important role in the funding and carrying out the processes with the help of some 20 universities and research center across the globe of the countries, like, you know, the USA itself, UK, Germany, France, Canada, China, many more. So these many countries, they were also helping in the process to run this project. So it is a huge project you know, that has been started, and this project, you know, completed in the 2003. So that means it took around 38 years to complete. So completion of this has come into the 2003 formally. Okay, during the process, like, you know, there was some private organization, they also, you know, started doing it parallelly. There was one called Celera Genomics. What they have done, you know, they started working it, you know, in the parallel manner. And this is, you know, the one of the center that is run by the Craig Venter, is one of the scientists who is running it. And they also contributed quite a lot in the human genome project. And complete eukaryotic genome, we come to know, you know, it came in, you know, after the 15 years of the, you know, the studying process. And that was the time NIH was actually headed by the James Watson, the same Watson, you know, the Watson Crick who discovered the double, you know, helix, or the helical, the double helical model of the DNA. And he had gone into the, all the details of the DNA, how the replication, transcription or translation must be happening. They had, you know, the very, very good idea about it. So same Watson was heading the NIH during that time, and which had helped a lot in understanding the process altogether. Okay, so it took around 30 years, and the incurring cost was somewhere around $3 billion. $3 billion are required to run this project. So you can just make out, if you go for the simple mathematics, what you come to know, one base requires $1. So 3 billion, you know, the bases require the $3 billion. As simple as that. And it took, you know, a lot of advanced technology. We'll discuss it in detail. And basically most of the part was, you know, to, in order to keep the precision part intact, you know, that was use of the robots, or the robotic uses in sequencing method was one of the, you know, landmark in that, so that the human error can be minimized. Okay, so that is how the human genome project came into the picture. And the human genome project revealed, again, just keep in the mind, it was just not like the human, it is like, you know, the using a lot of, you know, the other organisms. For example, they have sequenced the Drosophila in the process, which is insect. They have, you know, the decoded the information of the C. elegans, which is a worm. They have, you know, the sequenced the, you know, many other plants, like, you know, the like the rice, okay, and, you know, the many other plants, they have been, you know, sequenced in the process. And they try to look at into the physical map, genetic map, linkage map in the organism. So just, you know, the give you the brief, what is very important for us, like, you know, the 3 billion, again, like, you know, those 3 billion bases are distributed into the 23 pairs of chromosome. Okay, not every chromosome has the same bases, so depending upon the size, the it will vary. Usually the Y chromosome is of the smallest in size, whereas the initial chromosomes, like 1 or 2, they are, you know, bigger in size. And as you've been told, they have the two part of it, P and Q. Larger arm is called as P, and smaller is larger is going to be Q, and smaller is going to be P. So this is how we make it. Okay, let's go into the process, how it has been done. Okay, and what the information it has revealed. Okay, let's go into that.